بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين، أما بعد، فيقول المصنف رحمه الله تعالى في الأصل الثالث: بعثه الله بالنظارة عن الشرك ويدعو إلى التوحيد. The author, he mentioned in the third principle, knowing your prophet, the prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now he's mentioning that most important affair, and knowing that which the prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam he was sent with. بعثه الله بالنظارتي بالنظارتي عن الشرك. Allah sent him to warn from الشرك ويدعو إلى التوحيد. Now, this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sent his prophet with. And this beautiful manner that the author mentioned, he clarified, just as has come in the sunnah and in the life and the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, ba'athahu Allahu bin nidharati ani shirk, warning the people from shirk, wa yad'u ila tawheed. And the statement that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam he called to was just that, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah. And la ilaha, this is to warn from the false gods, and this is to be free from the false gods, and this is to declare and to believe that all of the things that are worshipped besides Allah, they're not worthy of worship, and to stay away from that, and to avoid that, and to be free from that, and to warn others from that. Naam, la ilaha illallah, except for Allah. And this is tawheed, that nothing is worthy of worship besides Allah, except for Allah. Allah, He's the only one who's worthy of worship, and everything that's worshipped besides Him is not worthy of worship. And this is what the Prophet was sent with, to warn the people from shirk and to call to a tawheed. وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ يَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتَ. And Allah, He mentioned, in verity, we have sent in every nation a messenger proclaiming to worship Allah alone and to leave off the false gods. All of the prophets and messengers, they were upon this call, the call to La ilaha illallah. They were all sent warning from shirk and calling to a tawheed. And the seal of them, likewise, he was sent with the same message. He was sent with the same message. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ba'athahu Allahu bin nidharati ani shirk. Bin nidharati ani shirki wa yad'u ila tawheed. The author, he says, وَالدَّلِيلُ قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى يَا أَيُّهُ الْمُدَّثِّرُ قُمْ فَأَنذِرْ وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ وَثِيَابَكَ فَطَهِّرْ وَالرُّجَزَ فَهْجُرْ. He mentioned the statement of Allah Azza wa Jalla, and the meaning of which is, O you enveloped in garments, and wadathir, man, dathara, dathara, and he covered him in garments. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we've seen in the previous classes that whenever he seen the angel Jibreel, he was frightened sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he came back to his family and he asked for garments to cover himself. And this happened more than one time. And whenever these verses were revealed, likewise, he covered himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then this was revealed to him. These verses were revealed to him. Ya ayyuhal mudathir. Nam qum fa'anzir. And he became a prophet with this messenger. He became a messenger with these verses likewise. And these are also the proof that he was sent to warn the people from shirk and to call them to tawheed. This is the proof for that which has preceded and for this issue here. Ya ayyuhal mudathir, O you enveloped in garments, قُمْ فَأَنذِرْ, stand, arise and warn. وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ, and magnify your Lord, and magnify and glorify your Lord. وَثِيَابَكَ فَطَهِّرْ, and purify your garments. وَالرُّجَزَ فَهْجُرْ, and keep away from the idols. وَلَا تَمْنُنْ تَسْتَكْثِرْ, and do not give in order to have more, nor consider that your deeds of obedience are a favor to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلِرَبِّكَ فَاصْبِرْ, and be patient for the sake of your Lord. And be patient for the sake of your Lord. So the author, now he has a brief commentary on these noble verses. وَمَعْنَ قُمْ فَأَنذِرْ, he says, and the meaning of stand and warn, يُنذِرْ عَنِ الشِّرْكِ وَيَدْعُ عَلِ التَّوْحِيدِ. So whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he commanded the Prophet at this time, قُمْ فَأَنذِرْ, arise and warn. And he arise and warn them from ash-shirk and call them to at-tawheed. Arise and warn them from the shirk, which is the greatest sin. And it is the sin that if one were to die upon it, it will never be forgiven. And the one who dies upon that shirk, a major shirk, then he will be in the hellfire for eternity, and all of his deeds will be invalidated, iyadhan billah, and he will never have mercy. Iyadhan billah. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was sent to warn from that. Qum fa anzir, ayunzir, an ashirk. Ayunzir an ashirki wa yad'u ila tawheed. That he warned from shirk sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he called to at tawheed. And as has preceded, this is the way of all of the prophets and all of the messengers, that they warn from shirk and they call to at tawheed. And this is the first statement that all of the messengers and prophets, they heard from all of the nations and the people of the messengers and prophets, that they heard from their messenger and prophet. And if we look into the Quran, we see that whenever Nuh came, he said to his people, Ya qawmi, u'budu allaha, ma lakum min ilahin ghayru. O my people, worship Allah alone. You have no other true God besides Him. And then likewise, after whenever Hud came, and Salih came, and Shu'aib came, all of the prophets, whenever they came, all the way to Prophet Muhammad, they had the same thing. And if we read in the lives of the prophets and the stories of the prophets in the Quran, they all said, Ya qawmi, u'budu allaha, ma lakum min ilahin ghayru. O my people, worship Allah alone. You have no true God worthy of worship besides Him. You have no true God worthy of worship besides Him. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. And likewise, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said the same to his people whenever this verse was revealed. He went to his people and he said, Ya qawmi qulu la ilaha illallah tufrihu. O my people, say that there's nothing worship, yani, but say that there's nothing worthy of worship except for Allah, and you will be successful. And he say that with your tongues and believe it in your hearts, and comply to what that necessitates. And comply to that what necessitates. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was sent with. And this is what this verse means. Kum fa anzir. Arise and warn. Eh? Yunziru an ash-shirki wa yad'u ila tawheed. Wa rabbaka fakabbir. The author, he says, azzimhu bit tawheed. And glorify your Lord. What does that mean, to glorify? How is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala glorified and magnified? Huh? What does it mean to make the takbir of Allah? Wa rabbaka fakabbir. Ay azzimhu bit tawheed. The glorification and the magnification and the veneration and the worship of Allah Azza wa Jalla, it is only by way of the tawheed. And ibadah is not considered ibadah without tawheed. وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ. We remember these verses, they're the first verses that were revealed for him to become a messenger, shortly after the revelation of the first few verses from Surah Al-Iqra, Al-Alaq. اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. And after that, the revelation, it stopped for a moment, and now it proceeded again with these verses. And this is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was commanded to arise and to warn the people. What was he commanded to arise and warn them from? He was commanded to arise and warn them from shirk, and to call them to tawheed. وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ. يعني glorify. عَظِّمْ رَبَّكَ بِالتَّوْحِيدْ. Glorify him and magnify him with tawheed. Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنه has been narrated from him that he said, كُلُّ أَمْرٍ بِالْعِبَادِ فِي الْقُرْآنِ أَمْرٌ بِالتَّوْحِيدِ. That every command in the Quran for ibadah is a command for a tawheed. يعني everywhere where there's a mention or of the word ibadah and worship in the Quran, what is intended by that is a tawheed. And there is no ibadah whatsoever, except if there is a tawheed. Except if there is tawheed, except by way of tawheed. In this manner, the ibadah will be ibadah. And if not, then it's not truly considered ibadah. Just like an individual, if he were to pray without wudu, then it would be said about him, you have no salah. You have no salah. But he stood and he made takbir. He faced the qibla and he recited the fatiha. And he made ruku' and he made sujood. And he made taslim. All of the affairs, he moved up and down properly. Huh? But he did not have a tahara. He did not have wudu. So then what will we say about him? Although he prayed physically, what will we say about him legislatively? Does he have salah? La, he doesn't have salah. It's easy for one to say about that person, ma salait. You did not pray. You did not pray. What you performed was not the prayer. Now, he still has the responsibility to perform that. In that same manner, likewise, all acts of worship without tawheed, without the other tahara, that is even more important than the tahara of the body and the tahara of the clothing and the tahara of the place that one is at, is that his heart is pure from shirk, that his heart is clean from shirk. And after it's clean from shirk, likewise, it's clean from nifaq and hypocrisy, and it's clean from loving the dunya and giving preference to the dunya over the hereafter and the love of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, until it's clear and clean from the having animosity and enmity towards the believers, until it is free from having jealousy for others and the likes. At this time, the heart will be purified and clean. وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ يعني بالتوحيد. Glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with tawheed by singling Him out alone in worship. So this is what he was sent with, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then after this, what did he say? وَثِيَابَكَ فَطَاهِرْ, and your garments, purify them. But the shaykh, what does he say? What does he say? رَحِيمَهُ اللَّهُ طَاهِرْ أَعْمَالَكَ عَنِ الشِّرْكِ, purify your deeds from shirk. And this is one of the positions that the ulama of at-tafsir have mentioned with regards to the tafsir of this verse. وَثِيَابَكَ فَطَاهِرْ, وَثِيَابَكَ فَطَاهِرْ, and your garments, purify them. Purify them. But here they are, some of the ulama, they mention this is with regards to the actual garments, that they should be purified and they should be cleaned and they should be free from all impurities. And this meaning is true. But likewise, from the meaning of thiyab, yani meaning from his deeds. Nam, and the deen. The deen is also considered a garment. And then, وَلِبَاسُ التَّقْوَى ذَلِكَ خَيْرٌ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentioned in the clothing of taqwa, this is better. This is better. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he seen people in a dream. One time they were presented to him, and some of them, وَعَلَيْهِمْ قُمُسْ, and they had garments on. Some of them down to their knee, or up to their knees, others up to their chest. And then he says, وَرَأَيْتُ عُمَرْ ibn al-Khattabi radiallahu anhu وَعَلَيْهِ قَمِيسٌ يَجُرُّهُ. And then he said, I seen Umar, and he had a garment on, he's dragging it behind him. They said, بِمَا تَأَوَّلْتَ ذَلِكَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, what did you interpret that to mean, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He said, الدين. الدين. So many times garments are, the garment is referred to as the garment that one wears, to cover his awrah. But likewise, also the word garment or thawb and the likes, libas, is used, and it's in reference to the deen. وَلِبَاسُ التَّقْوَى ذَلِكَ خَيْرٌ. نعم وثيابك فطهر. نعم, and your garments, purify them, meaning purify your deen. And طهر أعمالك عن الشرك, purify your deeds from الشرك, to purify them and make them clean. Some of the ulama, they mention likewise, ثيابك فطهر أي نفسك, طهر نفسك, purify your soul, purify yourself, purify from shirk, and the likes like this. So in any case, this is a command here for at-tawheed, and to purify one's deeds from shirk. And then it's clear, he says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَالرُّجَزَ فَهْجُرْ, وَالرُّجَزْ فَهْجُرْ. The author, he says, وَالرُّجْزُ الْأَسْنَامِ. Naam, الرُّجْز, what is intended by رُجْز? The idols. الرُّجْز, the idols. فَهْجُرْ, to turn away from them. To turn away from them. And to keep away from them. The author, he says, وَهَجْرُهَا تَرْكُهَا وَالْبَرَاءَةُ مِنْهَا وَأَهْلِهَا. And to make the hajr, which is their command here, of the rujiz, or of the asnam, it means to leave them, and to be free from them and their people. To be free from them and the people. Like this. So this is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was sent with. Naam, to warn the people from tawheed. وَثِيَابَكَ فَطَاهِرْ وَالرُّجِزَ فَهْجُرْ. Purify your deeds, purify your deen, purify your soul from shirk, and purify your body likewise, and your garments as well. The meaning is also suitable and correct. Purify your garments from filth and the likes. We know that at-tahara nu'ani. Taharatu at-tahara al-hissiyya wa at-tahara al-ma'nawiyya. At-tahara al-hissiyya, at-tahara min al-akdar. What awsakh, to purify, purification is from two types, pure, the one that is tangible and the one that is spiritual. So the purification that is tangible, meaning the one that is the purification of the garments and the clothing, the purifications of the place where one will be, and the purification of one's body and the likes like this, from filth and from dirt and from impurities. And this is one aspect of a tahara, and the other aspect is a tahara al-ma'nawiyya, the spiritual. The spiritual purification, and this is to purify the soul from shirk, and to purify the soul from the misguided and foul desires and whims, and from the lowly manners and conduct, and the likes like this. So here, وَثِيَابَكَ فَطَاهِرْ, to purify oneself and one's deen from shirk, وَالرُّجَزَ فَحْجُرْ, and to stay away and to avoid and to leave off and to be free from idols, idol worshippers, to be free from idols and idol worshippers, from disbelievers and from disbelief and from the way and from their ways. So it's clear that this is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he was sent with. He was sent with. نعم بعثه الله بالنظارة عن الشرك ويدعو إلى التوحيد ويدعو إلى التوحيد. The author, he says, رحمه الله أخذ على هذا عشر سنين يدعو إلى التوحيد. That he took to this for 10 years, calling to Tawheed. 10 years, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, calling to Tawheed, and he faced much hardship, and likewise his companions. These 10 years, what he's referring to now, 10 years in Mecca. The first 10 years in Mecca after receiving prophethood and messengership. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What was he sent with? He was sent to warn the people from shirk and to call them to Tawheed. It's an authentic narration from the Prophet that he said that إِنَّمَا أَنَا نَذِيرٌ. I am a warner. I am a warner. Naam. And then he said مَثَلُ النَّذِيرُ الْعُرْيَان. That I am like the naked warner. Yani the clear warner. Warning the people, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from shirk, and trying to guide them and be a means to take them away from shirk and the ways of evil, and to call them to goodness, and to call them to التوحيد. أخذ على هذا عشر سنين يدعو إلى التوحيد. He did this for 10 years, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, calling the people to التوحيد. وبعد the author, he says, وبعد العشر عرج به إلى السماء وفرضت عليه الصلوات الخمس وصلى في مكة 3 سنين وبعدها أمر بالهجرة إلى المدينة. That after those 10 years he was taken to the heavens, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and the 5 daily prayers were made obligatory upon him and his ummah, and he prayed in Mecca, establishing that obligation for 3 years, and after that he was commanded to make hijrah to Al-Madinah, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. With regards to the statement of the author, rahimahullahu ta'ala, he says, أَخَذَ عَلَى هَذَا عَشْرَ سِنِينَ. That he did this for 10 years. And he calling to التوحيد. Calling to التوحيد. We summarize those 10 years as we summarized previously those 40 years in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before prophethood. And we summarize briefly those 10 years, mentioning important points that occurred in those 10 years. And we see that at the beginning, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after the command here to arise and warn, kum fa'anvir, nam, and to warn the people from shirk and to call them to at-tawheed, he established that sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for 3 years. In private, for 3 years in private, calling people in private. And from the first to accept Islam from the men, Abu Bakr, and from the first from the youth, Ali, and from the first from the women, Khadija, and from the first from the freed slaves, Zayd ibn al-Haritha, and from the first from the slaves, Bilal. Radiallahu anhum jami'an. They were the first and foremost to accept Islam. And then Abu Bakr, whenever he accepted Islam, he started calling others likewise. And he called Uthman, and he called Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas, and he called Az-Zubayr, and he called Abdurrahman ibn Auf, and he called many of the people to Islam. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhum. In any case, the point here, for 3 years, the call was secret. And in the 4th year, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he was commanded to call out loud, to proclaim out loud, and to call the people openly. And at this time, he began meeting much harm. And his companions, likewise, they met much harm, radiallahu anhum, and much shidda and harshness from the pagans of Mecca. And it was a very difficult time for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam after the 4th year. All the way until in the 5th year, whenever it became very, very harsh upon his companions, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he allowed them to make hijrah. He allowed his companions to make hijrah to Al-Habasha. And they made hijrah to Al-Abyssinia. 12 men and 4 women. 12 men at this time and 4 women, they made hijrah and they left Mecca. They left their homeland because of how much persecution they met in the path of Allah Azza wa Jalla because of their faith. And from the leaders of those who left on the first hijrah to Al-Habasha was Uthman radiallahu anhu and his wife Ruqayya bint Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam radiallahu anha. Naam, that from the first of them, Uthman and his wife Ruqayya, the daughter of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they left and they made hijrah to Al-Habasha. Along with them, from the first two went to make this hijrah as well to Habasha, the first one was Abu Salama and also Salama radiallahu anhuma, and also from them Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and others. There were 12 men and 4 women in the first hijrah to Al-Habasha. And then it was a rumor that was spread in the same year. This was the fifth year, yani the fifth year. So after the fourth year became very far, very hard for them whenever the da'wah was proclaimed out loud. And then in the fifth year, the Prophet allowed them, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, to make hijrah to Habasha. 12 of them, 12 men and 4 women, they went. And then after that, they heard of some change, and there was a rumor that the issue got better in Mecca, so they came back, or they came close to coming back. And they came back, but they didn't all enter Mecca, right? They came back. Whenever they got close to Mecca, they found out that it was a rumor and it was a lie, and many of them turned back. Some of them continued to go, like Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. He went ahead and entered Mecca, and he was persecuted harshly. And he met great hardship, radiallahu anhu fi sabilillah, because of his iman. وَمَنْ أَقُمُوا مِنْهُمْ إِلَّا أَنْ يُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَمِيدِ. The only reason that they harmed them and they found fault with them and they persecuted them is because they believe in Allah. Because they believe in Allah. And they worship Him alone. They believe in the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So at this time the Prophet, he allowed for them to make hijrah again. Back to Habasha. More men and women at this time went to Habasha along with those who had already went back. And 83 men and 18 women at this time in the same year, the fifth year after the prophethood of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and messengership, on the fifth year they made hijrah twice. And this is the two hijrah, al-hijratayn ila al-habasha. In the sixth year after that, it was a great event. The uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he accepted Islam, Hamza. Radiallahu anhu. And right after Hamza accepted Islam, Umar ibn al-Khattabi radiallahu anhu, he accepted Islam. And after this, the believers, they become strong. And many of the, it's been narrated from Abdullah ibn Abbas, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, that whenever they before Umar accepted Islam, they could not even pray in front of the Kaaba. But whenever he accepted Islam, they started praying in front of the Kaaba. And because he was strong. And his Islam was strength for the Muslims. And whenever he became a Muslim, the Muslim became strong. And the Islam that he came with and the benefit that he brought to the Muslims was a great benefit. And they said about him, مَازِلْنَا عِزَّةً مُنْذُ وَالْإِسْلَامِ عُمَرْ. We continue to be noble and strong ever since Umar, he accepted Islam. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar, that somebody would say that about somebody's Islam. They came to, they were guided to Islam, and then that would be said about them, that this man, his Islam was beneficial for the Muslims, and that his Islam was strong, and whenever he became a Muslim, the Muslims along with him, they became strong, and they had honor and might. Allahu Akbar. This is Umar ibn al-Khattabi radiallahu anhu. In the sixth year, he accepted Islam, just after Hamza radiallahu anhu. After that, in the ninth year, Abu Talib, he died. And Abu Talib, he died as a disbeliever, yathin billah. But he aided in the Prophet. He aided and supported the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Quraysh was never able to harm him personally. Never able to harm the Prophet personally sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because of the defense of Abu Talib that he had. And the position that he had in the society. Whenever he died, Quraysh, they took advantage of that. And they started to harm the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam even more. And likewise, in the same year, in the ninth year, 3 days, it's mentioned in the books of Sirah, 3 days after Abu Talib died, likewise, Khadija died, radiallahu anha. Khadija bint Khuwaydin, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and his supporter and his aid and his helper and his companion, radiallahu anha, she died. And this was hardship for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To the two people who aided him and supported him, Abu Talib used to supported him physically and outwardly, and Khadija radiallahu anha, she supported him inwardly and aided him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this was a great difficulty and hardships that he was facing at this time, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored him. After this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored him after this, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then in the 10th year, brief, just after this, he brought him to the heavens. He brought him to the heavens in the night journey at Isra. He brought him to Jerusalem, to Al-Quds in the night journey at Isra. And from there, he proceeded to the heavens in the Mi'raj, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with Jibreel. And he wrote on Barak. And these narrations are well known. And these narrations are authentic. And he went to the heavens, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he met the prophets, many of them in the different heavens. And he went and he went before his Lord, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he went to the position where not even Jibreel could go. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to him directly and legislated for him and his ummah 5 daily prayers, Allahu Akbar. And then after that, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he descended and he came back into to Medina, and he made the Isra and the Mi'raj with his body and his soul. He left physically, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and came back in one night. And this is from the miracles of Allah, from the miracles and the signs of prophethood, and the signs of the power of Allah Azza wa Jalla, and that He can do whatever He wills. Tabaraka wa ta'ala. Subhana alladhi asra bi'abadihi laylan min al-masjid al-harami ila al-masjid al-aqsa alladhi barakna hawlahu linuriyahum min ayatina. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. And then the noble Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this was the greatest night of his life, and he was comforted in this manner after these hardships and difficulties. Innama al-usri yusra. Verily, along with hardship, there's ease. And he made that ease for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then after that, he prayed with his companions, and they prayed the prayer, and the prayer was legislated only 2 rak'ah. And they prayed 2 rak'ah for Fajr, and 2 rak'ah for Dhuhr, and 2 rak'ah for Asr, and 3 rak'ah for Maghrib, and 2 rak'ah for Isha. And then whenever he made hijrah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after 3 years from that, then he made hijrah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was allowed, him and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And after that, when they got to the Medina, the Salat became, as we know it today, 2, 4, 4, 3, and 4. So this is a brief summary of this issue here. And I summarize these events now. And this is because, inshallah, we try to finish this text soon, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. But I give the noble brothers and sisters glad tidings that inshallah soon we will start the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We will study the biography of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in detail. Bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. May Allah give us a long life and upon iman and upon piety to live, to establish that, and to study and to learn the biography and to know the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. هذا وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.